Thank you. pledge of our gratitude. May the bishops, priests, and deacons who serve at your altars guide the church in your spirit. We glorify and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Hallelujah. before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior, announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John, who proclaimed life to the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners. The Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The Apostle John wrote, "The feast of the dedication was then taking place in Jerusalem, and it was winter. And Jesus walked about in the temple area on the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, 'How long are you going to keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly.' Jesus answered them, 'I have told you, and you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify to me, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can take them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one can take them out of my Father's hand. The Father and I are one.' The Jews again then picked up stones to stone him. And Jesus answered them, 'I have shown you many good works from my Father. For which of these are you going to stone me?' The Jews answered him, 'We are not stoning you for a good work, but for blasphemy. You, being a man, are making yourself God.' Jesus answered them, 'Is it not written in your law, I have said, you are all gods? If it calls them gods, to whom the word of God came, and scripture cannot be set aside, can you say that the one whom the Father has consecrated and sent into the world blasphemes, because I said, I am the Son of God? If I do not perform my Father's works, do not believe me. But if I do perform them, even if you do not believe me, believe the works, so that you may realize and understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father.' They then tried again to arrest him, but he escaped from their power. He went back across the Jordan to the place where John first baptized, and there he remained. Many came to him and said, 'John performed no sign, but everything John said about this man was true.' And many there began to believe in him." This is the truth. Peace be with you. Been in the bulletin, but we've never made the collection. So we will put it in. into the collection again for next week. So next week's second collection will be the Patriarchal Charities. And what they are is all of these monies are gathered from around the world, sent to our Patriarch in Lebanon, where he then can be able to distribute them to the charities as he sees fit. And I don't know if you've seen the recent IEC announcement on the proliferation of the refugees in Lebanon. Of course, you've seen the news, so you know that the Prime Minister of Lebanon has been retired, or however it's worked. So there is a tremendous instability. And even as it is with the number of refugees and the works of charity going on, of course, then it's just to put you in consideration for what we could do next week in the second collection to help the Patriarch and to aid the Christians in the Middle East. If I perform the works of my Father, even if you do not believe me, believe the works, so that you may realize that the Father is in me, and I am in the Father. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. These 2 weeks, the consecration and the renewal of the church, are about life. Life is that interior principle of movement. It's one of the first things we experience as children, which is very mysterious. We see things moving across the floor, fuzzy cats, dogs. We grab them and try to figure out why they move. This interior principle of movement, whether it's in the plants or the leaves or whatever, is the source and the origin of everything that we do, we call life. In many ways, it's very mysterious. All last week, the Gospels of our Lord were about the life that is revealed in the Holy Trinity from our Lord's discourse of the Last Supper. As the Father is one and I are one, may they be one in me and I in you. Those beautiful reflections, which are a revelation of what God invites us, is to enter into His personal life, which we call grace. It's a gift given to us. This second week, the renewal, is our response to that grace. So the consecration of the Gospel is the invitation towards entering into the divine life, and here we have the question of how we individually react to this. And so we have this Gospel today from St. John. This is set in the winter, in December, of the few months before our Lord's Passion and Death. This is in the third year of His ministry. It is during the season of Hanukkah. And so it's that period of the dedication of the temple that they stand at. Certainly a reason in part why this Gospel was connected, but it is, as always, framed in a context. And chapter 9, just before this chapter, is the famous episode of the young man who is a beggar, who is blind and is healed by our Lord. And this young man receives not only physical sight, but also the grace of faith, following our Lord, believing in Him. What follows after this Gospel episode is the raising of Lazarus from the dead, an episode which you know very well, certainly, which takes place in the springtime. At the end of the Gospel of today, our Lord goes across the Jordan River and remains there for the next months of late winter, early spring, leading up to His Passion, because the resurrection of Lazarus is only a short time before our Lord's arrest and His Passion and death on Calvary. So we have, in the framework of this moment, of this clash with the people in the temple and the response to grace, we have the grace of seeing and believing and following our Lord. Following after this is the great lesson of our Lord that I am the resurrection, raising Lazarus from his tomb after 4 days of being buried. And so here we come to this juxtaposition in the middle of how we respond to God's offer to become essentially divine, to be divinized by grace, and to enter into the personal life of who God is. And that's why the Gospel, which has a number of things in it, was preceded immediately by our Lord speaking about being the good shepherd. That's why it's echoed today when he says to the people with him in the temple, if you do not understand what I'm telling you, if you do not believe, it's because you're not from among my sheep. You are not those who are following into eternal life. This is pretty harsh, but he's merely echoing their reaction to him. And that's why when they first come up to him, and they're in the portico of Solomon, they're on the eastern side of the temple, it keeps them more protected from the northern winds being December. And they come up to him and they ask the question, in fact they make a statement, if you're truly the Messiah, tell us openly. Now of course this phrase is insane. For over 2 years, almost 3 years now, he has been healing the sick, giving sight to the blind, freeing the possessed, and teaching throughout this three-year period, and yet they come up and say, well, do it again. Tell us that you're really the Christ. And that's why I said, I have told you, and you do not believe. The question which is understood there is, how much more do you want? How much more do you have to have manifested for you? And in this episode in the Gospel, as will be around Lazarus' resurrection, many just simply will not hear. They refuse to understand. There is a question of freedom in faith. Faith is never 2 plus 2 equals 4. It's 2 plus 2 equals... You can stare at the Blessed Sacrament as long as you want, and it will never look anything different than bread. And yet, we know by revelation that it is body, blood, soul, and divinity of our Lord. And this is what our Lord is saying to them. I have for 3 years told you, showed you. And then he goes on to say, if you do not believe me, fine, reject me, but you should be believing the works that you see. I and the Father are one. And of course, they go ballistic. And it's time to try to kill our Lord once again, several times, and this being another time. And that's in the confrontation. Why are you taken back by this? Believe at least what you see. We see the density and the hardness of people's hearts and of our wills. By the wounds of original sin, we seem to be deafened to hear the voice of God. And that's why twice in this Gospel today, on one, they're going to stone him to death, and then they still try to arrest him. We don't know how he gets away. St. John just simply says he escaped from their power. We don't know what it was. But then we're told that he goes to the other side of the Jordan. And there he's going to stay for these next months until his death, his betrayal and death on Calvary. But what is interesting is the last detail that St. John gives us. Because we're told that people follow him down to that area where John first began to baptize. 3-4 years ago now, when this all began, and John the Baptist was preaching and baptizing out in the wilderness, it's where our Lord goes to finish this story. And he remains basically in hiding there from the authorities in Jerusalem. But we're told that some people go down there. Doubtless some of them remember John the Baptist of just a few years ago. And they say among themselves, John didn't perform any miracles. John didn't do any signs. But everything that he said about this man is true. So what they're indicating is saying, we recognize that the very sign of John wasn't miracles, but was this man himself the Messiah. He must be the Christ. And that's why we're told that many believe at that point. They have heard, they have seen, they have understood. So this week of the renewal is our response to the invitation to enter into the divine life of who God is. This is our renewal. This is how that interior principle of movement in the natural order that we call life is transformed and elevated to a higher level. so that the principle by which we live and the origin and the source by which we think and act is divinized and made godlike. This is the grace of renewal. This is the beginning of the liturgical year. And when we understand this, that it is this week through the intercessions of Peter and Paul, that we ask for that grace to be able to see, and in seeing to be able to believe, and in believing to enter into that divine life of God, and to enter into that transcendent life of being divinized by grace. There is nothing greater that God Himself could offer to us than a renewal of our very minds and spirits. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
We believe in one God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial to the Father, through Him all things made.
Savior Jesus Christ and His plan of salvation for us.
We recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God to Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saints Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered for the repose of Alfred and Joseph. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Son, in the communion indwelling of the Holy Spirit,
be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship Him with humility. And just to glorify and praise you, O God the Father, for you are holy and the giver of life. You are blessed with your only begotten Son and your living Holy Spirit. You are surrounded by the cherubim and seraphim who sing with pure voices and heavenly melodies. They cry out, glorify and proclaim.
Yeah.
for your sinful children receiving your graces, we thank you for them and because of them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we profess our faith in you, and we ask you, have compassion on us, O God, have mercy on us, and hear us.
How awesome is this moon, my beloved, for the living Holy Spirit to send and rest upon this offering for our sanctification. Let us stand with
Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever. Compassionate Lord, may we, your lowly servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and holiness, and to call upon you, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Oh.
We thank you, Lord God and Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and the glory of your holy name and that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Jesus, Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.